Good evening, students. You are welcome to the course EDCR 121 Educational Technology. For today, for our objective for this session, we want to look at some basic concepts in educational technology. We want to understand what education is, understand what technology is. Then we'll put the two together and find the meaning of educational technology. Apart from that, we would like to understand what we mean by instructional technology. Then we'll go ahead to look at the difference between educational technology and instructional technology. Then the difference between technology in education and technology of education. I know you are ready with your pens and your books. If you have any question, you jot it down. The line will be open for you, or you can send your question earlier through the WhatsApp line that is given. 0503-923158. 0503-923158. I'm here with a colleague lecturer, Mr. Stephen Apeu Kwachi. He is a lecturer at the Department of Educational Foundations and is here to help me to do the discussion. And I am Mr. Bernard Mensah Amuakon, a lecturer at Counseling Department. You are welcome, Mr. Stephen.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yes. So, Mr. Stephen, we've heard of education. Education, every day we hear of this word. When you talk of education, what comes to mind?
Thank you very much, Mr. Bernard Mensah Amuakon. I think that basically we have to let our students understand that when we talk about education, it is one of those constructs that defies a precise definition. And for that matter, we normally say that universally we cannot have the definition for education, but we can have a definition for education.
All right.
In other words, every individual tries to define the term education from how he or she understands the term.
Okay.
And so when we go through literature, we realize that time over, every period of life, as in the 18th century, how they would define education would be different from how education would be defined in the 19th century.
Great.
The context is also important. Assuming you're coming from a developed world, how you would understand education is different from somebody who is coming from a developing country.
Great.
But basically, or in basic terms, we say that education is a process. It is a process because, like we are told in the house, education has no end.
Yeah.
So from the day you are born to the day you die, whatever you're going to go through is education.
All right.
Because it teaches lesson.
Great.
What am I driving at? What I'm driving at this evening is that education entails the acquisition of knowledge, the acquisition of skills, the acquisition of values, the acquisition of attitudes, and skills as well as habits.
Right. Yes, great. So you've made us to understand that to be educated means that we are trained as individuals to acquire knowledge, to acquire skill, and to acquire attitude. But what we have observed is that, yes, for the knowledge, we do well to acquire it because we need the content. The skill, how to go about things, we do acquire it. But the attitude aspects, what is lacking? That is difficult for the student to acquire the attitude aspect when it comes to education?
Yes, I think that yesterday I was sharing with my students that in the 21st century, knowledge is no more important. Everybody can buy a textbook, read, and get the knowledge. So I've met people who can read Bible in Chi, but these people have never been to education. Sorry, have never been to school.
Great.
I've met people who have done, excuse my words, certain courses, but they find themselves in other areas. The only thing that can put you in an area that you don't belong to is your attitude. And so if I'm an employer, it is better I pick somebody who has an attitude and not knowledge than somebody who has knowledge and not what? Attitude. You can teach everybody once the person is willing to what? To learn.
Right.
But if the person comes to the field and the person lacks the knowledge, the skill or the attitude, it is very difficult. And that is why getting a job is easy, but maintaining the job is difficult, because employers these days are not looking at the first class that you have. They are not looking at the second class upper that you have. But rather, what they look up for is your attitude. When you give people opportunity to work, come to work 7, they come at 7:30 with excuses. My mother is sick. I woke up today and I didn't have lorry fare. My light went off, and for that matter, I could not iron.
Our tap was not flowing.
Good, so I could not bath.
Okay.
This presupposes that, yes, you have the knowledge, you have the skill, but without the right attitude, maintaining your position in the field is very difficult. And that is why students have to understand that there is a difference between training and education.
Okay.
When it comes to training, there is that element of obey before complain. So when you go to training college, and our students who have been to training college would bear with us that the kind of expositions that they are exposed to are very different. It is a training institution. When you go to the military, what you go through is what? Training. That is different from what our students go through here. Because for education to occur, two things are very critical: transmission and understanding.
Right.
You get to the classroom, you are transmitting knowledge, skill, value, attitude. But a student would have to understand. In the military, you don't need to understand. But in education, you have to understand.
Great. So in education, you have to understand. So in summary, student, what we are saying is that education is a process of human learning by which knowledge is imparted, faculties are trained, skills are developed. And to educate means you have to acquire knowledge, you have to acquire skill, and in all, you have to acquire attitude. You may have the skill, you may have the knowledge, but for you to stay in the job, you need the right attitude to stay in the job. So we want to look at the forms of education. So we have the formal education, we have the informal education, and we have the non-formal education. With the formal education, we are saying it is organized and structured. Learning and training that takes place in a school. So with this type of education, that is what we are experiencing now. It is organized because there are some set of syllabus or some set of curriculum being guided, or that guides the learning approach. And it is structured because we have a lot of things that are put in place to ensure that by the time you complete with the program, you have acquired the needed skill, you have acquired the knowledge, you have acquired the attitude to be able to go out there to effect the changes that you require. Then again, we are saying that formal education examination are used for evaluation. So at every point in time, we need to go through evaluation. So here we have the mid-sem, we have the end of sem, even we have assignment, we have reading assignment, among others. These are to help us to understand whether what we are teaching you, you really understand it, or we have to go back to the content and teach it again. Then we talk about informal education. With that, I'll let my brother Stephen come in with the informal education.
Good. When we talk about informal education, what our students would have to understand is that basically it is all the experiences that we acquire in life that are not structured, that are not planned, and that is not guided by any curriculum.
Great.
And so, assuming your mother is teaching you how to prepare food, those days growing up in the village, our mothers, when you come to formal education, assuming your teacher is teaching you how to prepare banku, there is a curriculum. Take half bucket of water, add this amount of kondo, add this amount of salt. But in an informal setting, because it is not structured and it is not planned, and whatever happens is incidental and spontaneous, there is no curriculum. And for that matter, the narrative will now change from add one bucket of water, add a half, to your mother will just use whatever her intuitions tells her. So there are times you get home and they fetch the salt with the palm, just pour it into the soup, then they put the rest in the fire.
Yeah.
Informal education, there is no guided what element. So in totality, it is that experiences that an individual goes through from the day the individual is born to the day the person dies, where there is no prescribed timetable, where there is no structured curriculum, where everything that happens may be incidental and spontaneous.
Great. So most of the time, this form of education is unconscious.
Good.
You are not being sat down that, okay, today we are going to prepare banku. So if you want to prepare banku, first you have to get a source of fire. We don't do those things.
Good.
But most of the times, whilst the preparation is going on, your mom will call, oh, Ajua, can you get me this? Can you get me that? Can you get me this? Whilst you are doing those, running those errands, you are learning how to prepare the meal. So the method most of the times used in informal education, we have observation. You have to observe how things are being done. Then again, we have imitation. So then, mom is not there, but you want to cook. So you want to do it the way mom does it. And at times, it ends up either the salt is more than the banku, or the banku is more than the salt. Anyway, at least you have done something.
Yes.
Then again, another method that is being used in informal education is participation.
Good.
You have to get involved.
Yes.
If you don't get involved, it will be very difficult for you to understand how the thing is being done. So for the informal education, the method most of times we use is what observation, imitation, and what participation.
So here, one thing that we have to also understand is that even within informal education, within formal education, there can be what informal education.
Yeah.
When students come to school, they are placed in rooms with their friends. Though whatever they are experiencing in the school is formal education, once you are with your roommates, you are going to learn other skills, other values, other attitudes, other habits that are not guided and planned by what the school.
Example, the way you dress.
Good. The way you talk.
The way you talk.
The way you even walk.
Yeah.
There are certain schools that when you go there, or when you see somebody walking, you can just presume that this person attended this school.
Great.
By virtue of how the person what
walks.
Walks.
Great.
All these are informal. So within formal education, don't forget, with a formal one, we are just talking about that chronologically graded form of education. Okay. Class one, you move to class two, okay. You move to class three, class four, class five. It is chronologically what? Graded. Then it is hierarchically structured.
Okay.
So you cannot come here and say, okay, for me, and say, sorry, for me, I want to start from level 400 and trip
downwards. To level 100.
You have to move by virtue of how the structures have been. But in an informal one, you can decide to start from anywhere.
Yeah.
So we have people we meet, they talk, and you may assume that, this person is she 50 years. The person is just 10 years, but she talks like an ancestor.
Great.
Good.
Yeah. Then we have the non-formal. Okay. How does the non-formal looks like?
Good. With a non-formal type of education, it is that type of education that is provided for selected type of individuals within a population. So you have a population, assuming the church.
Mm-hmm.
So the church is a population.
Okay.
Within the church, you can go and have children's service.
Mm-hmm.
The children's service here becomes a non-formal type.
Okay.
So people who share the same characteristics. So assuming I am the pastor's wife of a church, and I say that after church today, all members in this church should wait. The married woman, and we are going to educate them about how to prepare liquid soap. Whatever education I give them is non-formal. A type of education that is provided for specific group of people who share the same characteristics for a certain purpose. In my community, for example, assuming there are pig farmers, there are poultry farmers, but I decide to organize a seminar or a workshop for the poultry farmers within my community, whatever education I give to this poultry farmers becomes what? Non-formal.
Okay. So can we term the workshop on the new curriculum as a non-formal education?
Good. It is, whatever we did was for people who share the same characteristics.
Yeah.
Assuming you are not a teacher, you cannot join that workshop.
Great.
For that matter, we say that in non-formal education, the characteristics have to be what? Homogeneous.
Okay.
So in the curriculum, whatever training that was given to the teachers, it was not for every teacher. Qualified what? Teachers. Therefore, that education becomes what?
Non-formal.
And so what our students would have to understand this evening is that basically there are three types of education. We have one that is structured and guided by strict principles given by specially qualified personnel. That is what? Formal education. We have one that you don't need any teacher. Life itself is a platform for you to learn. And so whatever you learn in your life that is not guided by any plan, any structure, is known as what?
Informal.
And then the type of education that is provided for selected individuals within a group of people is known as what?
Non-formal.
In informal education, there is no curriculum.
Okay.
In formal education, there is a strict observance of a certain curriculum.
Okay.
In non-formal, there is a flexible curriculum. In non-formal, it is not compulsory. Adult learning. My mother joined the class for 2 days. She dropped out. She came with a complaint. Hey, sana di suyedin. To wait, I didn't know learning was that difficult. You cannot use the grace you get in non-formal education to enroll in the university.
Yeah.
So if you attend a workshop and you are given a certificate, is it just for participation purpose?
Okay.
And not because we want to assume that you have acquired a certain knowledge that qualifies you to the next level as somebody who has enrolled in formal education.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stephen. If you have just joined us, this is EDCR 121, and the course name is Educational Technology. Introduction to Educational Technology. We have looked at what education is, the forms of education, which are the formal, the informal, and the non-formal. Now we want to look at what technology is. We want to look at what technology is. And we are saying that technology is derived from the Greek word technos. Technos means an art. Technos means an art. Art as in A-R-T. In the ancient Greek, when people talk of art, they are talking of skill, techniques, and ideas. And these skill, techniques, and ideas are used in drawing, painting, and sculpturing. So the art, which is the technology that they use, they are using these arts, this knowledge, this technology to preserve their culture. And they were doing that in the form of painting, they were doing that in the form of drawing, and they were doing that in the form of sculpturing. So you go to the various ancient world or the various ancient countries, you see the monuments. You go to Egypt, you see them. And these were the way in which they were using to preserve the knowledge that they have. They were using to preserve their history. So technology, as we know, is from the Greek word technos, which means an art. Again, technology has to do with all the ways used in invention, discovery, to satisfy individual needs and desire. So when we are talking of technology, we are not only talking of the gadget that we have today, but the various ways and means through which human needs are being satisfied are all part of the technology. So it's not only having a mobile phone, not only having a laptop, or it's not only having a tablet that demonstrate that you are technologically inclined, but even the processes that are being used to satisfy our needs are a form of technology. So then, technology can be explained in two ways. And what are these ways? We are saying that technology as a process and technology as a product. So then, technology can be explained in the form of a process and refer to it as technology as a process. And we talk of technology as a product. So now we are looking at process as a form of technology and product as a form of technology. So when we talk of technology as a process, that is one ongoing business of practicing an approach to doing a thing. This can be termed as the soft technology. The practicing that goes on cannot be touched. It cannot be handled. So those things that goes on within the individual's mind to be able to come out with a particular object or come out with a particular artifact, those things that cannot be touched, that those cognitive activities that goes on, is what is being termed as technology as a process, also known as soft technology. Then we come in again to see the product. So after doing all the cognitive activity, what comes out of it becomes technology as a product, also known as hard technology. So then if we take the building of a car, before you see the car, there will be a lot of drawings. There will be a lot of thinking. Okay, now we want to build a car to fit 2021. So how should that car be? How should be the model? How many types of tires should the car have? All these are the soft technologies. That's technology as a process. Then when this soft technology manifests in a tangible object, that's the car, we say that is technology as a product, and that is termed as what? Hard technology. That is termed as hard technology. So technology can be in two forms: technology as a process and technology as a product. So now we've looked at what education is. We've looked at what technology is. So now we want to put the two concepts together and see what we actually mean by educational technology. And there are a lot of definitions about educational technology. But the common one that we normally use is that of the Association of Educational and Communication Technology. That's AECT 2008. Association of Educational and Communication Technology. They define educational technology as the steady and ethical practice of facilitating learning, improving performance by creating, using, managing appropriate technological processes and resources. According to Association of Educational and Communication Technology, they define technology as the steady and ethical practice of facilitating learning and improving performance by creating, using, and managing appropriate technological processes and resources. When we look at this definition, there are certain elements we need to talk about more. So then, first, we look at the focus of the definition. And the focus of the definition is steady and ethical practice. Every profession has its ethics. There are some things you can do, and there are some things that you cannot do. Those things that you cannot do, we term them as unethical. So, using technology in education, there are some things that you should understand, and there are some things that you should be aware so that you don't use them anyhow. So if you want to use a certain technology to aid your teaching, to facilitate teaching and learning, you should first understand the in and out of that technology, and also know whether that technology is appropriate to the student level, whether GHS, whether lower primary, whether upper primary, and how well it can be used to aid the teaching. And how well it can be used to aid the teaching. So then, what we are saying is that study of ethical practice, that is the focus for the educational technology. That's the definition for educational technology. Then we want to look at the purpose. We want to look at the purpose. And with the purpose, we want to say that thank you.
FM. On the Bay. 98.3 FM.
You are welcome to Education Introduction to Educational Technology. The course code is EDCR121. And if you want to join us, you can do it via the WhatsApp line 0503-923158. Or you can call 0332320201. So before we had our break, we were talking about the definition of educational technology, and we said the common one that we normally use is that of Association of Educational and Communication Technology, and they define educational technology as the study and ethical practice of facilitating learning and improving performance by creating, using, and managing appropriate technological resources and processes. And we wanted to further understand this definition. So first we talk of the focus, and we said the focus of this definition is study and ethical practice. Then we are going on to look at the purpose of this definition, and with the purpose we are saying that facilitating learning and improving performance. So the purpose of educational technology to us teachers is to facilitate learning, to make learning interesting, so that the student will learn more and we will have to teach less. And now the new curriculum is saying that we are facilitators. So then our role is to facilitate the learning processes. And we can only facilitate the learning process when we understand the technology behind the learning processes, so that we can ensure and improve the performance of the student by using different technological products in our teaching and learning. Then again, another focus is the how do we do it? How do we do it? And from the definition, we do it by creating, using, and managing. So the various technological products that we incorporate in our teaching, some of it we cannot create it, we just have to go and buy it. Then we should also learn how to use it, and when we finish using it, we should manage it well so that we can use it for the next class. Most of the time we prepare teaching and learning materials, and when we use it, we don't preserve it. Some of them, yes, we can preserve it. Others, we cannot preserve it. But those we can preserve it, we need to manage it well so that we can use it for a very long time before getting another one. Then the last aspect of educational technology, the definition according to the Association of Educational and Communication Technology, is the what. And by the what, we are talking of technological processes and resources. So we need these technological processes and resources to be able to facilitate the learning and to improve performance. So we've looked at the focus, that is study and ethical practice. We've looked at the purpose, and the purpose is facilitating learning and improving performance. Then the how do we do this? We are saying by creating, using, and managing. And by what means? Through technological processes and resources. This is the understanding that we derive from the definition as the study and ethical practice of facilitating learning and improving performance by creating, using, and managing appropriate technological processes and resources. Let's look at the essential element of educational technology. Essential element of educational technology. You can still send your questions via the WhatsApp line 0503-923158, 0503-923158,
or you can call 0332-320201. All right, so I think we have a first message from our brother Divine, a political science level 100 student. And his question is, please, where can our given talent be classified in relation to the forms of education? In other words, where can we place our God-given talents when it comes to the three forms of education that we identified?
Yes. Thank you very much for your question. The name is?
Divine.
Divine. The God-given talent can be placed in all the forms of education, whether formal, whether informal, whether non-formal. All these, your God-given talent, because even when you come to the former, there are people who are by default intelligent, they are gifted. There are such people in class that no matter what you do, no matter the effort that you put in, you cannot get to him. They are always ahead of him. And so you always need to collaborate with those people to help you understand. When you come to the informal, we have people who have not sat in any classroom, but when they pick pen or pencil to draw, you will marvel. You will be shocked. The techniques that are being taught in the classroom, this person has not had any access to it, but he has been able to put those techniques together and be able to come out with a certain piece that you marvel. When it comes to the non-former, there are people who are gifted to do presentation. So when there's any workshop, we are pointing to, oh, you go and present on our behalf, go and present on. So the God-given talent can be manifested in any of these former forms of education, whether formal, whether informal, or whether non-formal.
Okay, so if I understand your points very well, then what you're trying to mean is that people can be born with certain things inherent in them.
Yes.
Everybody has a potential.
Yeah.
But for that potential to manifest, it can only occur through what? Education.
Yeah.
If you are a footballer, we have people who have attended academies to just more or less improve on their footballing what? Talent. We have others who may not go to that academy, but they may stay with their parents and go through the lifelong process of what?
Learning.
And we have others that will go through specialized kind of what? Training. And so, even though you may have the talent, you may need education. That education can be what?
Former, informal, or non-formal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bernard Mensah Mwakum. We have another from a tester. Hi, I am Brighton level 100, a political science student. Please, my question is, when you were speaking, you made mention of only one meaning of educational technology. Please, can you also give me another definition of educational technology apart from the one you stated?
Great.
Yes, then we have Bianca Gilbert from the political science student. And Gilbert, good evening, sir. This is Bianca Gilbert from the political science department, level 100. My first question is, can you please restate the features of the non-formal education? So first of all, can you restate the features of non-formal education? And to help you, I would want to say that first of all, non-formal education is not compulsory. Second, it is not what? Graded. And third, even though it is planned and guided by a certain curriculum, that curriculum is flexible than the one we experience in formal settings. The second question, please, what is the enrollment key for EDCR 121? And here I would want to respond by saying that Gilbert, the ICT department is trying to enroll you manually. And so from tomorrow onwards, if you still realize you have a problem with how to enroll, you can contact the various lecturers in charge, or you can go to the ICT unit, the IT directorate, and you'll be enrolled successfully onto the V class.
Yes, so one of our testers wanted to find out another definition for educational technology, and there are a lot of them. One by University of North Carolina Media Service, they are saying that it is the application of research, learning theories, emerging technologies, and child and adult psychology to solve instructional and performance problems. So there are a lot of definition that helps to explain what educational technology is. And I trust my student when they go onto the web, they can have 1,001 definition to help better understand the concept of educational technology. The line is also activated 0332-320201. You can call and ask your question, or you can also send a WhatsApp message on 0503-923-158.
0503-923-158. Good. Sir Bernard, good evening, sir. My name is Madia Tibaja. I don't understand your explanation of educational technology. Could you please explain it once more?
Yes. With educational technology, what we want you to understand is that we are employing technology to help improve learning. And we have come to understand that technology is not only the hard gadget. There are other things that we do which can also be classified as technology. That is the technology as a process, and we have technology as a product. So the main aim is we are employing technology and we are using it to improve performance. We are using it to facilitate learning, help our students to learn better. That's what educational technology aims to do.
Good. I'm Chairman Ten, Political Science Level 100 students. Please, where can the apprenticeship system be put according to the ties of education? And here, my brother Chairman Ten would have to understand that when it comes to any type of education that is not structured, that is not guided by a curriculum, and that is not operated within a specified period of time, we refer to it as what? Informal education. And so apprenticeship can be formal, apprenticeship can be non-formal, apprenticeship can be what? Informal. The features that you have to look out for is what we have already mentioned. Is there a structured curriculum? Is there a timetable indicating what they have to do within a specific period of time? Is it limited to a particular time frame? And so on and so forth. And we have, hi, I'm Samuel, a political science student. About knowledge and attitude, how can a person with good attitude but no knowledge work in an office he has no knowledge, thus no idea about? And here I think we talked about it by saying that we have met people who have done
different programs,
forgive my language, people who have done Akan in Zema, and they find themselves in the bank.
Yes,
they have no track record of accounting or management, but because they have the right attitude, it is very easy to build on that. But when the person comes and he has all the knowledge, the skilled everything, but he has no attitude, let me state here for our dear students to understand that knowledge becomes obsolete in a matter of time.
Great.
Whatever we are learning, it is not going to take us through all the years of our lives. There are times we need to improve, we need to upgrade.
That is why there is in-service training.
Good. On the job training, and so on and so forth. And so when people, irrespective whether you have done accounting or not, when you get to GCB Bank, you have to be retrained. Otherwise, you cannot work. And so if you do not have the right attitude and you get to these banks, how are you going to manage it?
The customers will even stop coming.
Good. And yesterday, I was drawing this synergy between chop bar operators and people who mostly operate restaurants. That people have chop bars. You go to their places to buy. If they don't have a change or a balance, they would want to roam the whole town just to make sure they balance you. They will not complain. You get to people who have received a certain form of education and they feel that, no, I don't have change. It's too early in the morning. You have been sent to come and destroy my work.
Right, there is a caller on the line. So, hello, your name? Hello? So you can still call 0332-320201, or send your message to the WhatsApp line 0503-923158. Yes.
All right. So my name is Anita Arthur, a level 100 political science student. My question is, can you please go over the definition of education and technology? Then, good evening, sir. I am Elijah, political science student. Please, sir, can you explain the difference between formal education and informal education? Then we have another message from Stephen from the political science department. The purpose of educational technology was about to be discussed until the advert came in. So you can kindly hammer on that for us. The purpose of educational technology.
Okay.
Then a message again from Kwati Emmanuel from Biology Education Level 100. My question is, why does the educational sector prefer those who have education attached to their certificate than those without it?
Okay. So one of the testers wanted to find out the difference between the formal education and the informal education. And the distinct thing about these two forms is that with a formal education, it is well structured and it is well organized. When you come to the informal education, it is less structured and it is less organized. Then another text I wanted to find out about the purpose of educational technology, about the purpose of educational technology. And with the purpose of educational technology, what we were saying was that it is to facilitate learning and improve performance. The aim of technology is to facilitate learning. So imagine you are to dictate the notes to the student. There is a caller on the line. Hello. Hello. Your name and program, if you can hear us.
Hello.
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 Yes.
Hello.
Yes. Talk. I can hear you.
Hello.
You can still try the line 0332-320201. So the purpose of educational technology is to facilitate learning. And I was saying, in those days where we had to dictate notes, it was taking a lot of the instructional time. But now that we have projector, hello? Hello, your name and program. Hello, you can still call. The number is 0332-320201. Whilst we wait for the calls, we'll go to our WhatsApp messages.
Please, my name is Oche Godfred, aka Omar Dax, a level 100 student in Geography Department. Please, can non-formal education adapt some feature of formal education? Can non-formal education adapt some element of formal education?
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening. Your name and program.
Please, I'm Salome Blagoji, level 100 student.
All right. You are welcome.
Thank you. Can you please go over the education, the technology, the way you were talking about, the purpose, the how, and then the what?
Okay. I'll go over. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Hello. Okay, so you can still try the line 0332-320201. So we want to find out, you wanted to find out the various meaning of the educational technology definition, and with the purpose. The first one is focus, and the focus we are saying steady and ethical practice. Then we also want to know the purpose. The purpose is to facilitate learning and improve performance. Then the how. The how is creating, using, and managing. Then the what is technological processes and resources. We'll go back.
All right,
to our
thank you. I think sir, we would have to move to the Facebook Live.
All right,
and we have two questions. I'll take the first one, of which I'll try to answer, then I'll leave the second to you. Please, I am Fuseni Salam from Geography Department. Please, in formal education, certificate is issued. In non-formal, certificate is issued. So please, what is the difference? The difference is that the certificate you acquire from formal education can be used for upgrading yourself in your school, in your job, and everything. But most of the time, the certificates we acquire from non-formal education can be used only to promote or upgrade ourselves in the job place and not in our educational system. So this is to say that when we apply for admissions, assuming I have attended a workshop, I cannot apply for admission based on the number of workshops that I have what attended. You can only apply for this school based on the certificate you have acquired from formal what education and not from non-formal education. So my brother, the second one, please, I'm Samuel Larry from the Geography Department. Please, my question is, do we use scientific method in educational technology?
Yes, we use scientific method in educational technology, and that was what we were going to talk about when we were discussing the essential element of educational technology. The essential elements of educational technology. First, you have to identify the educational problem that you want to solve. You have to first identify the educational problem that you want to solve. Then again, you have to understand the audience and their needs. You have to understand which level of student are you teaching and what is the problem that they are facing that you want to solve. So in the midst of COVID, the government took to radio took to teaching their students or teaching students on radio. So this is a form of technology that is being employed to help our students learn in this time of COVID. Then again, specification of goals and objective. So you have identified the problem, you have identified the audience and their needs. Now what is the goal? Then again, you have to establish priorities among the problem. Student problems are many. The educational problems are many. So which of them do we have to solve first, or which of them do we have to solve later? Then examination of the various alternatives. So after knowing the problems and how to solve it, there are other means of solving the same problem. So you have to develop the various alternatives to solve the educational problem. Then identify the necessary financial, physical, human resource prerequisites in achieving the established objective. And the last is to development of feedback. You have to develop feedback so that the student or those who consume the technology will give you a feedback.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, please, I'm Sewa, political science level 100 student. Can you please mention some of the components of educational technology?
Okay.
Then we have, good evening, sir. I'm Moses Tete. My question is, do we have only three purposes of educational technology? Because I have only three. Good evening, sir. I am Nathan Amu, a political science level 100 student. Please, can you give some examples of educational technology? Good evening, once again, from Divine, a political science student. Please, if I got you right, the methods and the approaches used in delivering teaching can be termed as the soft technology, and the outcome, hence, as the hard technology. Second, does it mean certificates acquired from non-formal education is not really valuable as compared to that of the former, since it cannot be used to further and upgrade your educational status? Then, Wisdom Money Park Combien, political science level 100. Please, why is it that the knowledge we acquire is always not the reflection of our attitude? So you meet students in the midst of COVID, you ask them to wear their nose mask, and they tell you COVID is not real.
So then this one, it boils down to the individuals. The individuals have their own philosophy and they have their own understanding of issue. As you said, people are being advised that the main reason why we have to wear the nose mask is to prevent the spread of COVID. And that's the only thing we can do to stay in school. But most of the times you meet students and they are not wearing the nose masks. You ask them and they will tell you that, well, for me, I don't believe that there is COVID. But we need to protect ourselves so that we can stay in school for long.
Good evening, sir. My name is Akufo Charles, political science. Sir, please, can you go over the fourth stage of the definition that tells what we work with, technological processes and resources, and what can help us to build our technology resources.
Okay. So with the technological processes and resources, we are talking of those things that we use in facilitating the learning. And by the how, we are saying that you have to create it. So some of these TLMs that we use, most of the times, teachers create their own TLMs. At times, so they buy it. And when you buy it, you have to use it in the lesson. And you are using it in the lesson to facilitate the lesson process and also to improve performance. Because if you go and your teaching is always one way, most of the time, student becomes bored. But if you use different methods and you introduce different gadgets or introduce different processes in teaching, always the students are ready to learn because they know that every day there's a new thing that is being used to explain concepts for them to understand better.
Good evening, sir. I'm Vincent, level 100 student. I just turned on my device. Please, what topic are you teaching, sir?
We are talking about educational technology. We've learned what education is. We've looked at what technology is, and we are discussing the definition of educational technology. So if you have just tuned in, this is what is going on, and you are welcome.
I'm Alice from the political science department. Please, my question is, can you say a feature of formal education is that supervision is needed and motivation are given to workers to work hard? And here I would disagree to say that in formal education, the only thing that we can say is that qualified personnels give education. For example, when you come to this university, everybody that you meet in the classroom is a qualified personnel. You not meet somebody who does not qualify teaching a particular subject that he or she has no training in. But in non-formal, if it is the church, still you have agents and agencies. Just that these agents and agencies, they have not been employed fully. So in the church, I may have not just a certificate, I may have a practical training. I may be a carpenter. I may want to share my experience with what? My people. I don't need to apply with a master's degree or a PhD. But in formal education, you need, as an agent, you need to apply with your training. In informal, there is no need for you to apply. And that is why we said that in informal education, you can learn from everyone, anyone, anywhen, and anyhow.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Steven. We'll take about 3 of our WhatsApp message, then we'll summarize today's lecture and we'll bring it to a close.
Good evening, sir. How beneficial is educational technology to the physically challenged, i.e. visually impaired, among others?
Yes, so to them it's important because now we have some technologies that are being used on their various laptops that can even read tests to them for them to also to be part of the learning process.
And here we can mention JAWS as an example.
Yes.
Good. Sir, good evening. Do have a good evening, sir. I am Isaac Etonam from the Political Science Level 100. I would like to know some of the ethics expected from a professional teacher and some of the non-ethics. Then, good evening, sir. I'm Richmond. Sir, please, can you repeat the definition and forms of education? Hello, I'm Rebecca from... Please, what are the objectives of education?
We have a caller on the line. At least we've gotten one through. Hello, your name and program. Hello. You can call 0332-320201. Yes. And we want our student to understand that if by any means your question is not being answered, you can still have the opportunity to answer them when we get to the classroom. And you have the opportunity to also seek for further clarification. Thank you very much. Today we've looked at what education is. We've looked at the forms of education, which is formal, informal. Hello.
Hello.
Good evening. Lower your set, or you move away from your radio set.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Yes.
The lesson has gone very well. I come up with the lecture, but I'd like to suggest that my colleagues. My name is Diana from Home Economics Department.
Okay.
And we should just divide it and record so that some of the questions will not be repeating itself. That's my observation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for your observation. So we talked about the various forms of education, which is formal, informal, and the non-formal. Then we went ahead to look at technology. We said technology comes from the Greek word technos, which means an art. And we've looked at technology as a process, which is also known as sub-technology, and technology as a product, which is also known as hard technology. We looked at educational technology, the full meaning of educational technology, and we also went further to understand some words that are being used in the definition of educational technology by association of education and communication technology. Then we've also looked at the essential element in educational technology. Thank you very much, students. We really enjoy your participation in this radio lecture, and we look forward for your participation in all other radio lectures. Thank you very much, and see you in class tomorrow as you have the opportunity to further ask questions. Thank you very much.